thing is, how many Marines can they take with them? And that's what they did. They ran through the 5th Pioneer area, A Company, B Company, and C Company. They slaughtered the Air Force mechanics, and they killed a lot of our men. And that morning, Erdman, Arthur Erdman, who spent 36 days with me in the foxholes, he said, "Sam, you stay with the gun. I'm going out to see what is all the commotion. What's all this here firing going on?" I had to stay with the gun. So he saved my life because he said, "Stay with the gun." He no sooner got out of the foxhole, and this Jap killed him right in front. The Jap kept coming at me, swinging this. He swung this, but he had two bullets in him because I saved two cartridges. They took away our ammunition. They took away all our ammunition because they didn't want to board ship a Marine's gun with live ammunition. They should have taken the ammunition away from us as we boarded ship, not the day before. Because there's an old saying, and it came later on in life, and Yogi Berra said, "It's not over until it's over." And it was not over. And men had died because somebody took our ammunition away on Sunday afternoon, and all I had was two rounds. I fired them. The man came and fell in my foxhole, swinging this here, and I had to finally finish with a K-bar. I'm sorry to say.
That's the knife that you have
this
there.
This is not the one, but this is what I had for protection. That's all I had.
And that was his helmet.
This is his helmet, and that's his saber. I put those two items, I'm a kid, take them home. I put them in the front loader that we had. One of the front loaders had a big box for tools. And several of us put our trophies into the box and closed the box up. And the government took it home for us.
And this is your...
And I got that in the sea bag, and then I had some people, friends of mine, who befriended me in California, a family. They drove up and took the sea bag away out of Camp Pendleton when it was all over, and I got them home.
Well, then there's the... followed by in August, August 6th, August 9th, the bombing of... atomic bombing of Hiroshima, Nagasaki. Well, you find yourself in Japan later that year, and you actually went to Nagasaki 4 or 5 weeks after the actual bombing. What was your visual?
Well,
of that?
The bombs fell in August 6th and 9th, I believe it was, and we went to Sasebo, Kyushu. That's the southernmost island of Japan, and Sasebo is where the Imperial Japanese Marines were located, and also they manufactured the one-man submarines there. And our job was to disarm anybody who was there. We were there 2 days, and they decided they had to send us into Nagasaki, which was about 25 or 30 miles from where we were in camp. And we went in just for maybe 5 or 6 hours to make sure there was nobody there that could carry weapons or anything. It was destroyed. The place was absolutely flattened. And thank God we didn't get cancer. They put in film in our cartridge belts, 127 film, little film in those days we had. Mm-hmm. And if they were developed, then we would have had cancer, but we didn't develop.
Well, the point system, and you have a total of 78 points, and a lot of the veterans of World War II of that era know what the point system were. It's based on service, where it was. But you had 78 points, more than enough to come home.
Yeah, the point system, as soon as the President of the United States declared the war is over, anybody came from the draft, which I did, actually, was allowed to be discharged immediately. Well, we're in Japan. So the only way you get home is to have points, because the point system tells you who goes home first. And every day we'd look on the bulletin board, and finally the points came down from 90 to 86, and then 85, and one morning 78, and mine was 78.
And Corporal Bernstein is now going home. And on January 1st, 1946, you land in San Diego, the same journey, 1 year to the day, January 1st, that you actually shipped out to Iwo Jima.
Right.
You then get back home, and on January the 29th, you are discharged, and you have this big reunion at your house. Yeah. But the same day, you were invited to a bar mitzvah.
All five of us came back.
All five the Bernstein boys, right, and the mother and father, and you find yourself at a bar mitzvah, where you meet Roberta, who is to become your wife of 56 years.
Yeah, I didn't know Roberta. I got off the train. There was nobody at the train to meet me, and the cops there took me to this temple where there was a bar mitzvah. They said, your mother and father said, bring you there. So I went there. When I got there, it was a very emotional reunion between the family. But the people who had the bar mitzvah came up to me and said that they wanted me to come to the party that next day at Sunday at the hotel, a big party. I said, I don't know. And they said, oh, yeah. And you, the lady said, you can sit with my niece from Boston. I said, how old is your niece? And she's 17, a senior. I don't sit with a 17-year-old niece. I just came back from Japan. Mm-hmm. I said, but by the way, which one is she? And she pointed her out to me in the temple there. I said, that's your niece? I'll be there.
Well, 56 years later.
I married that girl.
You, 2 years later. November 14th, 1948, you marry, you have three children and seven grandchildren.
Right.
You then go to into business and have a successful career.
Right.
And it's been an amazing life and just a fascinating veteran story. Mr. Bernstein, I'm going to ask you if you would to dedicate the story to who you would like, and then I would like to end by a poem that you had written.
The poem?
Well, you had written a poem March 7th, 1945, while sitting by the cemetery in 1945.
I don't know.
You were not a writer, haven't written before, haven't written since, but it was a magnificent poem. I'd ask you if you would share that.
That is my poem. I was on a cemetery with Chaplain Gittleson, and we were burying some boys. And I got very upset, naturally, and I sat down on one of the graves of a boy I knew, and I had a paper and pencil. I had a bag with a bag. That's all it was. And I started writing my mother and father a letter. I wrote it, you know, dear mom and dad, I just saw a sight to see. And as I was writing, this officer came over to me and came down, bent over, and he said, son, what's wrong? I said, nothing, I'm just writing a letter here, but I don't know if I'll ever leave this island. He said, well, if you give me the letter and give me the name and address of your mother and father, I will take it to Guam today. He's a pilot of one of the planes. And he said, I'll send it back to your mother and father. And I gave it to him.
Could you share that poem with our audience?
On March the 7th, I wrote. I don't know how I wrote it. Oh, I just saw a sight to see, a sight that will always live in me. And there they were, row on row, the graves of boys who gave their all. Here a cross, there a star. Try to see it, because here they are. A Catholic, a Protestant, and a Jew. All American boys we once knew. And though you read so many thousands dead, you know not what you really read, because only these who see their graves will ever know and be amazed. So to the ones who must receive a notice that they've been bereaved, the boys, they died for four great rights, and we alive for all time must keep them bright. And when it's over, God make it soon, let's not forget, ere we're doomed, that war is hell, and pray we must to keep the peace they gave to us. I'd like to dedicate that to the boys who died on Iwo all over the world, and to my wife, who took me at her early age. I was told never to get married because I'd never make 35. And thanks to my wife, I made 81 so far. She brought me back to where I was when I was a kid. Thank you, Roberta.
Thank you, Mr. Bernstein. Thank you for watching. We'll see you next time.